much for the music. The point was, but the music is like.
Save mine for this apple pie and ice cream.
You bought more ice cream?
And Dutch apple pie.
I just dumped that ice cream out last week.
You what?
I thought that stuff you had out last week.
Uh-huh.
I think a little bit of butter pecan. Huh?
I didn't bring butter pecan though.
Okay, have it around here too long. I'll eat it.
So James gonna eat pecan.
I'm gonna get rid of it.
That's why I got vanilla. I have butter pecan, I took it back.
Shalom, shalom, Mr. Picard.
Shalom, shalom.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Shabbat shalom.
It's a pleasure, as always, seeing everybody here today. And we're going to have another dynamic lesson by our executive, Maury Eliyahu. And I pray that everybody had a good week.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
I had a good week also. And just looking forward for all the great things that the Father has promised us Only thing that we have to do is keep the faith, stay consistent, and he that endureth unto the end shall be saved. All right? But the key is that we're going to have to make sure that we abide by all of the rules and regulations that the Father set for us to do in order to be in covenant relationship with him. Anybody have any testimonies, anything they would like to share before we get today's Shabbat lesson started? And if not, what we'll do is we'll go ahead with the lesson. Okay, we're going to all stand up, face the east. I'm going to blow the shofar 7 times, and we'll have our good brother Abad Yahu to bring us in with prayer.
Bless this lesson and to truly open our minds and our hearts to your word today. Let that be a nourishment to our body, mind, and soul. We pray for those who couldn't make it, that wanted to make it. We pray for all of Yahshua, and we're just happy to be here today. Praise you once again. And I ask this all through your begotten son's name, Yahshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Shalom, everybody.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom, everybody.
Shabbat shalom.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We will, first of all, give honor to Av Yahuwah, the Elohim of Israel, the one and only Elohim. We thank the Most High for His Son, HaMashiach Yahusha, for being the atoning sacrifice and the Redeemer of the nation of Yahshua. We thank him for his goodness, kindness, and his mercy that he has bestowed upon us. We thank him for his protection, how he protected us out throughout the week. Hallelujah. We thank him for continuing to be a provider like he promised to be, providing us with food, clothing, and shelter, and meeting our needs on a daily basis, going above and beyond what he promised to do. I mean, above and beyond what he promised he would do. And we thank him for that. And I thank him for each and every last one of you being here today. Just want you to know that I love you and I'm lifting you up in my prayers and just ask that you do the same for me. And at this time, we're going to go into our lesson. We're going to continue from last week. We talked about endeavoring to endure. And, you know, just wanted to go over some scriptures that would be words of encouragement for the nation of Yahshua, because our people, you know, we deal with a lot. We go through a lot on a daily basis. And, you know, looking at the prophecies and where we are within the prophetic realm and the plan of redemption, you know, he's already, you know, paid the price and shed his blood so that we could be redeemed. We're waiting on him to fulfill the rest of the promises of these prophecies. And we're going to go to Isaiah 61. Isaiah 61. Matter of fact, let's go back to Isaiah 60 and we'll finish that off. Starting at verse 16, then we'll go to 61. You know, I like the book of Isaiah. He's one of my favorite prophets. And, you know, this is a book that, you know, when I was in the Christian church, they stayed away from this. They stayed away from a lot of the prophets, to be exact. So we're going to start at Isaiah 60, or Yeshayahu, the 60th chapter. We're going to begin at the 16th verse, because I think this was the last verse we left off on last week. So we'll begin there this week.
Okay, on the book of Yeshayahu, the book of Isaiah, the 60th chapter, verse 16. Thou shalt also suck the milk of the Gentiles, and shall suck the breast of kings. And thou shalt know that I, your Redeemer, and I, Yahuwah, am thy Savior and thy Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob, Yaakov.
Now that's very important. He said, I am the Sovereign, or I am the Sovereign and what?
Savior.
The Savior and thy Redeemer. Thy Savior and thy Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob.
That's right.
It's very important that we focus on these things, because Jacob, or Israel, is in need of what? A Savior, and they're waiting on what? Their redemption. They are waiting to be redeemed.
That's right.
Israel, or Jacob, is waiting on their Savior, who is also their Redeemer. Because, you know, we get this thing mixed up a lot. I remember even being in the Christian church, how I remember them saying that song so much, I am redeemed, I am redeemed. I've been washed in the blood of the crucified one. And that's all over Christendom. Not knowing all. Jacob, Israel, the nation of Yisrael, that's who's going to be redeemed. Did he say, know ye not that you're not your own? Mm-hmm. He said, you've been bought with a price. Mm-hmm. You've been purchased what? By his blood, or with his blood. His blood was shed for the nation of Yisrael. And you know what? I know that's a bitter pill for people to swallow. When people hear this, and it just goes to show you the importance of a nation of people, Israel. It just goes to show you how important they are to the Most High. That all of these things pertain to Israel.
That's right.
His blood was shed for Israel, but you got to go back and read and understand these covenants. That's why all the covenants, they never left the bloodline of Israel and jumped and went to another nation of people. If you know what happened within that covenant, then you can see and you will know the importance of why his blood was shed for the nation of Israel and the nation of Israel only. I'll say this one more time. His blood was shed for the nation of Israel and the nation of Israel only. Is that saying that the other nations are going to be neglected or left out? No. But we have to keep scriptures, we have to keep the writings in perspective. And in the right perspective at that.
Absolutely. Well, just a quick scripture to help support what you're saying here.
Yes, sir.
The book of Matthew, chapter 1, verse 21. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Yahusha HaMashiach. For he shall save his people from their sins.
He shall save who, Maureen?
And he shall save his people from their sins.
Whenever you read the scripture, you're reading about Yahuwah and HaMashiach, they always use possessive pronouns.
That's right.
Possessive. And they always pertain to his people. If my people, which are called by my name, he always keeps in perspective of him and his people, he and his bride, the nation and the land that he placed his name upon. Go ahead, boy.
Verse 17, for brass I will bring gold, and for iron I will bring silver, and for wood brass, and for stones iron. I will also make thy officers peace, and thou exactors righteousness.
Now, when we see this, you remember when we read in Isaiah, the 16th, not Isaiah, but Ezekiel, the 16th chapter, how he talks about upgrading the nation of Yisrael, and when he found what a hot mess she was.
Yes.
He fixed to do it one more time. He's going to upgrade her again. And what he fixed to do, he's going to turn the nation of Yisrael's situation around. He's fixing to change their position. He's fixing to change their status again. And that's what I like about when we get on the, in the next chapter, you're going to see how he's going to do it. Go ahead, Mark.
Verse 18, violence shall no more be heard in your land, wasting nor destruction within thy borders. But thou shalt call thy walls salvation and thy gates praise.
Now, how's he going to do this? How's this going to come about?
Violence shall no more be heard in your land, wasting nor destruction within thy borders. But thou shalt call thy walls salvation and thy gates praise.
He's going to clean it out.
Thank you. He's going to clean it out. Right. Everything in there going to have to get up and go. They're going to have to unask that land. They have to get up and go.
That's right.
They're getting up out of there. That's exactly how he's going to do it. Go ahead, Martin.
Verse 19. The sun shall be no more thy light by day, neither the brightness shall the moon give light unto thee. But Yahuwah Elohim shall be unto thee an everlasting light, and thy Elohim thy glory. The sun shall no more go down, neither shall the moon withdraw itself. For Yahuwah shall be thy everlasting light, and the days of thy mourning shall be ended.
Wow.
Wow. Mm. Your people also shall be all righteous. They shall inherit the land forever. The branch of my planting, the work of my hands, that I may be glorified or esteemed.
Now, you see that? He said, your people also shall be all righteous.
Mm-hmm.
He said, they shall what? Inherit the land, because the book has always been about the inheritance. Israel is his firstborn. There's a firstborn inheritance. Everything is predicated upon the land. Israel have never really enjoyed the inheritance. Because as soon as they stepped foot in there, they ran straight through the back door. Mm-hmm. Just refused to get somewhere and sit down. You know us. And then what he said, the branch of my planting. Why is he saying the branch of my planting? Don't you hear all these people talking about they been grafted in? Into what? Yeah, they said they're the branch that's been drafted.
Exactly.
The grafting process, but they didn't. This is all about Israel. Remember, he said the branches were broken off.
Mm-hmm.
So if the branches were broken, and we know these branches he's speaking of is plural, he's talking about Israel and Judah. Mm-hmm. And when he brings them back together, they won't be branches, okay, because they were a branch before they became branches. And he's fixing to plant them. He's going to reunite and plant them once again. We can read about that in Isaiah the 37th, so we're not going to turn there. But if you want to know about it, go to Isaiah the 37th chapter. I mean Ezekiel, I'm sorry. Ezekiel 37. And I may be esteemed. He said, go ahead in the last verse more. I'm sorry.
A little one shall become a thousand, and a small one a strong nation. I, Yahuwah, will hasten it in his time.
He said, a little one shall become what? A thousand. And a small one a what?
Strong nation.
And Mosiah said he's going to do what? He said, I will hasten it in his time. Why is this verse here so significant? What's going on here?
He's going to build up the numbers back up.
How are you going to build the numbers back up?
Birth records.
Exactly.
One should be, does that mean that little one is, let's say, a husband and wife that are going to end up being a thousand. Is that correct?
Right. It's going to be all he's going to. Israel is once again. Y'all think we're fruitful now? Nah. Israel is going to be fruitful once again. Right now we can't build a strong nation because we're leading all over the world in abortions. Yeah. Everything comes out of us. What we do?
Aborted.
We abort it.
Sure.
And the transition that this earth and what we're going to go through, it's going to be a lot of people lost. He already told you about 2/3 of Israel.
Mm-hmm. So this is after 2/3.
Oh yeah. Okay. Because he promised to what? Save all of Israel. He said, I'm not going to leave not one of my sons or daughters behind. He didn't do it in Egypt, did he? So he's going to do the same thing again. And when we come out, he's going to hasten this thing. And you know it's going to be so far. It's going to be a time when he said men are going to what? Seek death or seek to die and won't be able to find death. Israel is going to become great once again. You got some more?
No, I mean, okay. Verse 22 is very important, just like you said, because if you look at this, no holds barred, and follow exactly what the scriptures are saying here, especially what we got going on in verse 22. The promise was that Israel would be as the sand of the sea. The sand of the sea. Mm-hmm. But because we as a nation didn't follow the law, statutes, and commandments, remember Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter, it talked about the Father set before us life and death, blessings and cursings. Mm-hmm. Right now, we're under the curse. Mm-hmm. Meaning this, Israel is not few in numbers. It made mention in Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter, that our women, okay, would not bring forth seed the way that they used to. All right? And then just like Maury said now is that if you look at statistics, all right, especially amongst the so-called black women, a woman, they abort their babies like crazy. It's off the charts. All because of this black feminist movement that's going on. Mm-hmm. Our people are selfish and they're very arrogant. Mm-hmm. Call it for what it is. Mm-hmm. Selfish and arrogant. And it is time for us as men to stand up for what these scriptures is telling us, what it really is. Mm-hmm. What it really is. It says children are the oppressors, mm-hmm, and women shall rule over them. Come on now, we have to really stand up and speak exactly what the Father is telling us to speak. Ezekiel, the second chapter, it says what? I send you to a rebellious house. A rebellious house. Look at that word rebellious in Hebrew and look at the definition. A stiff heart, stubborn, wicked behind people. If I were to come to any other people, they would have repented a long time ago, but not Israel. Not Israel. Because in this society now, this backwards feminist society, they push the female agenda and push the man back to the side.
Yep.
That's what they do. But it's now time for the right men in Torah to stand up, not being abusive, but saying, listen, you know what? This is the law, this is what the Father says, and you have to follow the law. This whole world is out of sync. And then in ending, it says that the Father now is going to have to cut the time short, or he says he's going to have to hasten this time here. Because if this thing was to continue on the course that is heading on now, there would be nothing left here to save. This world is going to hell in a basket. Mm-hmm. It is picking up speed every single day. Mm-hmm. Every day.
Exactly.
Go ahead, Warren. This thing is getting crazy.
And I was just, it's so crazy that you bring that. I was just thinking about this yesterday. I was sitting in my office at the desk and I was like, just thinking about how you can see the agenda that they have against men. Just men in general. Because it is so easy now for a man to lose everything just simply off of accusations.
Yep.
You don't have to do anything. He can be accused of it mm-hmm. and lose everything. And I'm talking about going back 20, 30, and 40 years on accusations. Mm-hmm. And not to say that some of these accusations aren't true. That would be unfair and biased to say if some of these things weren't so. You know what I'm saying? But you can see, even when it comes to the law, they say if a woman is in the act with a man, and after the act is over, if she said that he did something that she didn't want him to do, no matter they're going all through the whole act, this man still can be prosecuted and can go to jail.
That's right.
Even if she can see.
I don't think she had to say, I didn't want that. Afterwards. And I'm like, wow, that's crazy. But you see how they're trying to set the man up? But this is not an attack against women.
No, it's not.
But then watch when it comes to the other man, or when it comes to homosexuality and homosexuals. Let me put it that way. I told y'all. Let me say these are not the views of Comcast. Put my disclaimer out there.
That's right.
These are strictly my views, and all the rights are going to them. And this is why, and our people understand, this is why it's the Most High speaks. He speaks about the land his people are, he called it spiritually what? Egypt.
Yeah.
And what? Sodom.
That's right.
And you have to watch this and know what's going on. That's a reason why the Most High say he's going to hasten this. Y'all know what hasten means?
Make it go fast.
He's going to make it go fast. Because let me tell you something, we've got to a place, and this is why, you know, he's talking about doing all of this stuff? Where? He's going to bring Israel back to their land, because guess what? When you're in your land, nobody else's legislation and laws supersedes and reign and rule over you. Mm-hmm. And this is why it's so important. Because I'm going to go here, and a lot of Israelite women, they do not like to hear this. Our entire culture, our constitution, everything that this book that we're reading about, even from Adam going all the way through, it's built off of multiple wives. I know some of y'all might say, Adam didn't have more than one wife. That's another lesson, but he did. Everything is built off of that. It's built off of patriarchal, what's the word I want to use? Huh?
Society.
Yeah, that's good. For a reason. The 12 tribes come out of what? Multiple wives. This is so important. But a lot of Israelite women, they don't want to get with them. They can't see it because And I understand we have a lot of brothers who have put a shed bad light on a lot of the culture. And so it just turns our women away when we talk about these things. But I'm trying to show y'all the importance of why he's speaking like this in Isaiah. He already knows what's going to happen. He already knows Israel is going to be what? Fruitful, and they're going to multiply again. He promised to what? Even before the New Jerusalem descends and comes to earth, this body will go through a change. Before that change takes place, where we go from mortal to immortality, he said we were going to go back to living again, like what? Living as trees. He said to be 100 years old, well, to be, will be likened as to being what? A babe.
That's right.
He's going to renew everything about you. The 15 or 16 teeth that you got in your mouth, they're going to go back to 30. How many we got?
32.
They're going to go back to 32.
That's right.
He's going to rejuvenate. He's going to rebuild. He's doing that for a reason. We are going to produce once again. And it's very important to see when you're in your land, under your culture. One thing somebody cannot show me is where Israelite men were allowed to go get a second wife because she was fine and they wanted to lust.
That's right. It's right there.
You don't find that in here. As always, a purpose and a reason for a an additional isha, a wife, to be brought into that union. It was never allowed because, man, that sister down there fine. I'm thinking, I'm going to make her part of this union. Because first of all, when you get that attitude, now all of a sudden, you have something now where you desire that more than the wife you already have. And what did the Most High write in the book about he that has more than one wife? He should not diminish what?
The first wife. The first
right.
Wife.
Should not diminish the value or diminish the first wife.
She's no more.
We see that with Rachel and Leah and Jacob, right? The one that he loved the most. What was the one thing she couldn't do for him?
Give him a child.
She couldn't give him a child. Because he loved her more and desired her more than he did his first wife. The Most High don't go back on his word. It wasn't until the other women got in the hand they began to what? To make fun of her and all that stuff, and she went before the Most High and prayed. But had they stayed in order, she would not have given him a child, because the Most High, he's not going to go against his word. And it goes to show you that this is a mindset. Israelites, men and women, are going to have to start rethinking and reprogramming their mind. Because, let me tell you something. It's all about building your house, increasing the kingdom.
It's good.
It's all about, because every one of us in here, even though we are a community and one family, individually, the husband and the wife mindset still should be what? To increase and build their kingdom. When you're in this house, this is your kingdom. And together, you should be working together to what? Increase your kingdom, increase your what? Territory, and to build. And sometimes it takes what? If a coachee, the hardest you work, when she leave that doctor's office every day, sometimes, even though I know she's your Isha, she has responsibilities and all, but sometimes when you hit the ground, you don't want to come in here and cook a four-course meal. You don't want to have to do that then get the children together, get them ready for the night and get you ready for that evening or that night. So guess what? Now you start sitting down and seeing how and why you can see the necessity to what? to add to the union. There's nothing wrong with adding to the union. As long as what?
It's an order. It's an order.
It's an order. I remember before me and my aunt Isha got married, I remember one of the first things she asked me was, how do you feel about multiple wives? And I told her straight up, you know, I'm an Israelite. It's written in the word, I agree with it. And that's something, I'm not saying I would do it now, but I'm not against it. And there might be a time I want to do it. And we had that honest discussion, and I remember her words exactly. I asked her, I said, well, how do you feel about it? Because I'm seeing how, if we're going to cut this off now, we're going to be able to move on. And she said, well, she said, I agree with it. She said, all I ask is that if you desire that, it's done in respect. Don't just show up to the house with one day with some woman and saying, this is my second Isha. That is kind of cold and disrespectful. She said, I just ask that you include me in it. It's a process where we make the selection together. Mm-hmm. And I don't think you can be any more fair than that. But I thank the Most High for my wife that she was humble enough to even sit down and have that discussion with me. You know what I'm saying? And like, you know, I was telling her, at this time where I am now, I don't see what's something that I want to do right now, because both of us, we're too busy right now to be doing anything. But we had the discussion, and if that's something that I want to do, we've had the discussion. And like she said, it's something that I would be, you know, humble enough and righteous enough to say, hey, love, can we sit down and have an honest talk? I think this is something I want. Let me see where you are, and let's see how we can move forward with this process. And that's something that most Israelite men don't do that with their wives. And these people are just bring, I mean, because you have to be careful who you bring into your union.
Absolutely.
Under your roof, right. Under your house.
That's right.
You have to learn people. This scripture says, know them that labor amongst you.
Mm-hmm.
You have to learn that person. There needs to be a rapport and a relationship of sisterhood built between these women who are going to be, because they're not going to be individuals. We're talking about being one. We are talking about being one. And just like wife number one came by way of a ketubah or a contract, wife number two has to what? Come by way of an agreement, a contract, and know exactly why she's been brought into that union, and she has to know exactly what benefits she's going to receive for obliging or abiding to the terms of that contract. I don't know why I'm going here, but I feel the need to go here, because we're living in a time where we don't know, before the Most High bring us out and before we enter in Jerusalem, we don't know if Solomon, James are going to be with y'all. Mm-hmm. You don't know that. You don't know what can happen between that time. So guess what? You are not going to want to be without someone or heirs, and to have heirs to leave an inheritance to. This is what one thing the Most High even discussed and wrote even in the scripture. We're supposed to be able to what? Leave an inheritance until our children. Mm-hmm. You know, if you try to do it here, what's going to be expected of you in the land? And I often talk about the nation of Yisrael has been downtrodden and been poor so long. You can easily manage what you have right here with one Isha. Imagine trying to manage five 100,000 acres, 50,000 cattle, 30,000 sheep. I'm just giving you an idea how prosperous Israel, the nation of Yahshua, was. Your inheritance, what you receive, you had to have children on top of children on top of children, plus, guess what? Servants to oversee all of that stuff.
That's right.
It's because of our mindset. See, we keep trying to use a Western mindset and use the mindset that we have here because we have little. This is a humongous house that we're sitting in today. Compared to what you have in your land, this is little. So it takes a large family. It takes the extra help with hired servants and all to help take care of that. Matter of fact, let's go to, who are we at, Maury? I know I'm in the book, though, and I know the Most High is leading me here. Y'all might not think so right now, but you will.
You'll see. Oh, yeah.
Okay, yeah, we're in Isaiah 61 now. We can go to Isaiah, the 61st chapter.
Okay, one thing. I just want everybody to know, as Maury put up the disclaimer, me and Maury did not talk.
Okay.
All right, we did not talk today at all, not even yesterday. And so we just wanted to share with everybody how important it is for us to understand a mishpachah, a family. I've been in a situation, or heard of situations, where a brother might be interested in a second Isha, all right? And she knows a young lady in the whole nine yards. That's her sister, they love each other the whole nine yards. All of a sudden, that woman is now a bee, a whore, and some of everything else in the world now. All of a sudden. But again, when we look at a mishpachah in a family, what a family is supposed to actually be, we can all be in a community, living together. You have your Isha, you have your Ish. Everybody's doing good. But the act of sharing, and a lot of our people are so selfish that they don't like to share. I got mines, and mines is mines. They don't have the mindset of bringing everything together and living together as a community. From Genesis to Revelation, it is always talking about living together as a community. But this society now has taught us now is that, again, I got mines, you get yours. And I told all of my brothers here, you have to be very, very careful about with some of these sisters out here. Meaning this now was that we had a situation some years ago with the woman who was a Desiree Washington. Now, this woman now was supposed to have been on her Nita. On her Nita, her and Mike Tyson are talking on the phone. It's 2-3 o'clock in the morning, and she goes over to the hotel where Mike Tyson is. Now, she's on her Nita. Now, come on now. If you go to a man's hotel, okay, at 2-3 o'clock in the morning, what time do you think it is? We was already talking on the phone. If I go to your house, okay, at 2-3 o'clock in the morning, you already know what it is. Now, Mike Tyson being the person that he is, he had intercourse with her, didn't call her back. Now she feels humiliated. I had intercourse with this man, he didn't call me back. I feel like you raped me.
And that's all it takes, too.
Yeah, exactly. There are so many men out here on false accusations now of being called rapists, perverts, and all these things. And these men have to go to jail based upon a woman's false accusations. And according to Scripture, whenever a person now is been accused of something, he is supposed to be brought to the courts. Brought to the courts.
With witnesses.
Exactly, with witnesses. Mm-hmm. You just can't go and bring a man to court and say, bring up accusations against a man that he's a bum, he's an adulterer, and all these things. And then the woman gets to decide where she's now the executioner and judge at the same time?
Right.
This is what society teaches, but that's not Torah. If you have allegations against a man or the woman against a man, you have to go to court.
Right.
There was a man he had a jealous ruach upon him that he thought that his Isha had committed adultery on him. He has to now bring that woman to court. He can't just give her a bill of divorce. He has to bring her to court. And this court now is supposed to be organized based upon Torah. So now they go through the preliminaries. You see the judge, she takes off her head covering, she drinks the bitter waters and the whole nine yards. But this is the thing. If that woman did not commit adultery, that man can't put that woman away for the rest of his life. Because you are not supposed to now abuse the name of the daughters of Israel.
Exactly.
You can't do it. And neither can you now abuse the sons of the father either. Because the father's not a respect of persons. You see what I'm going here now? Is that you can't abuse the name of the woman, and you can't abuse the name of the sons either. But there's a lot of women, okay, with this feminist movement and this whole thing with LGBT, all these other crazy acronyms. Listen, there's a movement that is going on. It is being pushed by the adversary to destroy the black or the Hebrew family. Okay, this is not it started in Genesis. I must destroy this man and woman coming together in one akai to be a family. It started in Genesis. It is still being done today, and you would think that our brothers and sisters would be able to look at the scriptures and understand that there's a plot to destroy you.
Yeah.
A plot to destroy you. Because you never know what that next great leader might come from. And it might come between you and you, a Hebrew couple. Who was it? J. Edgar Hoover said they had this big plot out where they said, you know what, they wanted to stop the possible rise of another black Messiah.
Yeah.
Come on, man, I'm not making this stuff up. Maury's not making this stuff up. It's time for our people to really wake up. But the father said he's going to speed up the time, and not everybody's going to be able to make it. I don't care how long you've been in the walk. 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, it doesn't matter. If you're not willing to abide by all of the laws, statutes, or commandments, you're not going to be able to make it. And I tell my two young brothers here, you better be careful. You better be extremely careful, because one wrong move, you're going to find your behind in jail. You're going to have a criminal record. And if you get a criminal record, your chances now of getting a job are slim to none. I guarantee you, you don't want that on your jacket. All right, there's a bullseye on your back. A bullseye on your back. And have always, from the very beginning, tried to destroy the Israelite man from the very beginning.
From day one.
Don't believe that crap where the woman is talking about she can be independent and still be in right accord with the father.
No.
Listen, man, I can't have a relationship with the Father, Yahuwah, without having a relationship with the Mashiach. I can't do it. And so there's no way in the world. Show me one scripture. One scripture, and I will bow down to a woman. Show me in the scripture where that woman can operate separately from her Ish and have a relationship with the Father. Even when the father saw the woman, the Mashiach saw the woman at the well, he asked her, where's your husband?
First thing, where's your husband?
Where's your husband? Can you imagine me coming to your house and just walking into your house? Listen, the order is, you're the man of the house. Well, I'm going to wait here until Zabud comes home, and knowing that Zabud don't get home until 12 o'clock at night. Now, here I am at 6 o'clock in the afternoon, 6 o'clock in the morning. What the hell I'm doing in your house at 6 o'clock in the morning?
Exactly.
Huh? Bro, listen, our people have a weird, exactly, listen, man, and I'm going to say it, your wife is your possession.
Yep.
That's your possession. That's your Isha. Listen, we've been taught a whole lot of crazy stuff here in the land of Babylon, of Sodom and Gomorrah. Listen, man, we better really, really wake up. I ain't even going on a rampage with this thing here, but Maury, you went on this title well, for a reason.
Yep.
It's time for our people to wake up.
And you said something key, understanding how to respect our sisters.
Right.
I remember one time I came by here, Zabu wasn't at home, and I was sitting in my car because I was on the phone, and a Koti Yedaya came to the door, and when she said he wasn't home, guess what? I pulled my behind off and I left. I know we're a community, we're family and all, but I have no business having my behind in this house with you out of the house.
That's right.
And I know I'm going to respect my sister. Mm-hmm. I love this family too much. Mm-hmm. But as an Israelite man, there's still an order in a way we do things. Mm-hmm. There's a way we do things.
Man, it totally keeps down confusion.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And even when, and I'm glad you said that, even when, or if you agree, or when Israelite couples agree to bring another Isha to that union, there's still order to it.
That's right.
And there's still respect that goes along with it. You're not fixing to have no menage a trois? No.
That's no.
Because that's not permitted.
No. Mm-hmm.
They're not permitted in the same bed. Matter of fact, wife number one can't know anything that goes on with what? Wife number two? Mm-hmm. Wife number two is not permitted to know anything that goes on with wife number one. Because that's off limits. Because it keeps down confusion. Mm-hmm. And it keeps what? You in a cot with one another, walking as one. Mm-hmm. And if you look at how it is in the scriptures, when Hagar got out of control and Sarah kept going to Abraham, mm-hmm. what did Abraham do?
Told her to beat her down.
You know, this is, you know, you over her.
Yeah.
Pretty much the authority that he had given her, wife number one, she was to regulate her because she was over her. And that's what we have to understand. And Maury said something so key then. He said, abiding by all of the laws, statutes, and commandments written in Torah. Mm-hmm. And that's a beautiful thing. I know y'all hear us harp on about the 10 and the covenant. That's for a reason. But what changes when you get back in your land?
You fall back under those.
Right, because 613. That 613 is the constitution that was given to Israel to govern them in their land. You can't take somebody outside, bring their constitution into the United States of America and think it's going to supersede the United States Constitution. That's not going to work. And it doesn't work. And I've gotten several arguments with Israelite brothers trying to enforce laws and stuff that they see in the scriptures and hold people accountable to it. In this land, you cannot do it. Because anything should go awry, and you end up in the court system here, guess what laws they're going to be judging you on?
That's right, their laws.
The Constitution. Mm-hmm. It's the body of legislation that governs this land. How you sitting over here as a captive? Think you got your own thing going.
But you know, more, I would say that when you are, let's say you have 613, we know that we are not bound to those here in this land. But if there's part of that that would benefit us or we can keep, then I think we should. Give you an example of something. I'm not forced. I mean, in this land, under the constitution of this land, I can eat what I want to eat, you see. But in my home, I make the rule that you can't eat pork. Mm-hmm. You can't eat, you know, based on what? Based on not the constitution, but here it is, I should have the right in my home to say, this is how it's going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You see, again, to a certain extent.
That's what you're saying.
You can't force nobody to, if they don't want to live, they don't have to live here. You try to keep here, just kidnapping. You see, but saying that somebody will, even though I have a right to eat pork in this land, I decide not to because I want to follow Yahuwah. It's not going to hurt me not to eat it, is what I'm saying.
Right, but what I'm saying is they don't have a law in the United States that says you can't eat pork.
No, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying, that since, even though they don't have the law, I'm still following the law of the word. You see?
Right. I see what you're saying.
Eat the pork.
Right. But even with that, it's not so much the 613 you're following.
Right.
Because you remember the dietary law was already established before the golden calf was ever built.
That's true.
He made a difference between clean and unclean before the 613 were given.
Mm-hmm.
People say about homosexuality, they say, well, it speaks about that in Leviticus. And the Lord, I said, yeah. I said, but even before then, he had already laid out how procreation worked.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. He created the woman for the man.
Mm-hmm.
He made what? Him male, her female?
Mm-hmm.
When he told Adam to put these animals on the ark, I mean, not Adam, when he told Noah to put the animals on the ark, how did he tell him to put them on there?
Two by two.
Clean. I mean, clean. Unclean.
That's what I'm saying. And then I forgot what it was for clean.
Seven.
Seven, yeah.
But they put both, if we would call it gender, it was both genders for procreation.
Mm-hmm.
Everything that people try to use to knock, and I'm not talking guilty at the gym because you meet people outside of it. That's what one time when I was teaching, I said everything that people use to try to come against or still try to pull us under the law, the thing they come up with, it was already established pre-golden calf. Everything was the dietary, because we could easily stick with the 10 alone and just even stick with what was written before they built the golden calf, and you'll see it was already established from the Sabbath all the way down.
And that was even outside of their land. So outside and inside.
Right. And so that's what I'm saying. Even when we get back in our land, that's a constitution that we will yet have to abide by, because we will be what? A kingdom again? We will be a nation.
Mm-hmm.
We will have our prosperity again. We'll have our inheritance back, which is the land. And guess what? We're going to have to take care of the land according to what? Those laws won't change. If he said let that land rest for the seventh year, guess what we're going to be done doing?
That's right.
But you see, in our land, we have a body of legislation, a constitution that's already prepared, already ready.
Mm-hmm.
Outside of the land, what he gave us, the covenant that we're under, guess what? We can keep that whether we're in captivity or not. There's nothing written in the Ten Commandments that we can't keep and cannot do. That's our covenant.
Mm-hmm.
That was established before. Moses didn't come down off of the mountain after they built the golden calf and come up with 10. He had the 10 already given before they created the golden calf.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to Isaiah 61 right quick.
Okay.
And
the book of Isaiah, Yeshayahu 61. It says, "For the set apart spirit of Yahuwah is upon me, because the sovereign hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the sovereign and the day of vengeance of our Elohim, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion. Verse 3, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, to give unto them the oil of joy for mourning, to give unto them the garment of praise for the set apart spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the sovereign, that he might be esteemed or glorified.
Stop right there. Did y'all pay attention to verse 3? So, even though we're reading in the book of Yeshayahu or Isaiah, is Isaiah going to be doing this?
No.
Or is he prophesying, he's speaking of someone?
He's prophesying of the sovereign.
Hmm?
He's saying that the sovereign is going to do that.
Did he say that, okay, when you said sovereign?
Or Yahusha.
Yahusha, okay then. And you said what? To proclaim what? Did not HaMashiach come doing these things?
Except for a year.
And to point to them that what? Mourn in Zion. Is he talking about Zion? A land? Or is he talking about Zion, a people? Zion, a people. You know, you can read in the scripture and find and see what Israel is Zion. Well, Israel always, I mean, not always, sometimes identified as Zion. Zion always pertained and made reference to not only the land, but the people as well.
That's right.
You looking for something more?
No.
Okay, then.
Okay, we have verse 4.
Let's go back to the last
okay.
sentence in that which talks about that they might be called what?
That they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of Yahuwah, that he might be glorified or esteemed.
Did we not read in the previous chapter about Israel? About being who was going to plant them? That Yahuwah was going to plant them. Let's go to verse 4, Maureen.
Verse 4. And they shall build the old waste. They shall raise up the former desolations. And they shall repair the waste cities, the desolation of many generations. And strangers shall stand and feed your flocks. And the sons of the alien shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers.
It said, and strangers shall stand and do what?
Feed your
flock. Mm-hmm. And the sons of the aliens, as mine say, shall what be your what? Mm-hmm. Plowmen and your what?
Vine dressers.
So if all of this is going to be taking place, that lets you know you are where?
In your land.
Back in your land, and you have received what?
Your inheritance.
Mm-hmm. Why is the stranger doing all this?
That's their salvation.
Yeah. That is kind of their salvation. If we want to look at it that way. And not only that, because you can't do it by yourself. You cannot, your inheritance is too much and too big for you to try to do what?
Do it ourselves.
To do it yourself, you can't. And this is the thing that Israel has to get into their finite mind. What you have endured and gone through here, when the Most High promised to esteem and barak you, you are going to have an increase that, I mean, it's going to blow your mind. Because I'm going to tell you what messed people up. The nations and Shaitan, let me tell you, very tricky. That's what I like to see things like. There are videos out where people have done teachings, but most people in school know better anyway. When you see the continent of Africa, the way they have it positioned on the maps and on the globes, you look at stuff like Africa seem like it's no bigger than Europe.
Yeah, it looks small. Yeah.
Which is crazy. Do y'all know how big Africa really is, that continent? The continent of Africa is so big that all the other continents will fit inside of it.
Inside of it. United States, all of it, at the same
time. All of them at the same time. But why do they present this stuff to us that way? Because they really don't want us to know, as a melanated people, how big and powerful we really are. So if Africa, that continent, if it's that big, what size do you think Israel is?
A lot bigger.
A whole lot bigger. Mm-hmm. That little small piece of land that they keep trying to show y'all, mm. What belongs to Israel, that land is massive.
It is.
Then he said we were going to be as the sands of the sea? Mm-hmm. You think we all could fit and reside comfortably over what they call in Israel today? Mm-hmm. If that's the case?
You know what I was thinking about? Whenever they would say the sands of the sea, I would think about the beach. But then, for some reason, when you said it a little bit earlier, I thought about the whole ocean, which is the sea, and all of that sand that's in it. More water than there is land. So he's talking about the sands inside that ocean. Not a lot of people. Or am I wrong?
Well, we don't know how much sand is inside the ocean. I mean, you got rock and well. Exactly. I mean, but either way, it's a large number.
Yeah, it's just a lot of people.
It's innumerable.
Yeah.
And so what I'm saying, with Israel, we have more than what we can imagine. Then he said, eyes have not seen,
mm-hmm.
nor ears have heard, mm-hmm. neither has it entered into what? The heart of men, what he has in store for us? And that's why, if this man, if he's telling you that the forces of the Gentiles are going to be brought over, the gates to the city are going to be open daily, that their wealth be brought over? Your territory, what he has for you, is just beyond what you can imagine. And that's the thing with Israel. We have to get our mindset in that place. We have to start thinking that way now. Not get over to the land, then all of a sudden you start thinking or becoming kingdom-minded. You should be kingdom-minded right here. Your preparation should be starting right here. And that's the thing, as Israelites, we haven't gotten there yet. Because all we can think about is our situation and what's going on with us here, what we don't have, what we want, what we need. That's what he told you to what? Don't store up your riches here.
That's right.
He said store them up where? In the kingdom. But your mind should start being transformed when? Hmm? Every day, or right now, tomorrow, the next day. Go ahead, Morris.
Okay, I'm going to read verse 4 again. It says, and they shall build the old wastes, they shall raise up the former desolations. Mm-hmm. We have to identify who's the they. And they shall repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. And strangers shall stand and feed your flocks. The sons of the alien shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers. Now, to go along with that, you got Psalms 2 and 8. And we talk about inheritance. And what is the reward for us as Israelites if we keep these laws, statutes, and commandments? The book of Psalms, the Tehillim 2 and 8 says, ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathens for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for your possession. How can we get around that? So there still remaineth a rest for the nation of Israel. There's still an inheritance for the nation of Israel. And Maury has been saying for the longest, ever since I came down here to Georgia, what has happened with the nation of Israel is that we've gotten comfortable
in captivity. Yeah. So we don't even realize we're still slaves or still in captivity. And that's why I keep telling people that diversity is not necessarily a good thing. Because you know why they preach and teach diversity so much? Because if you can come under that, grasp hold of the understanding of diversity, being a mixture and understand all of these different cultures and everything else, it's easy for you to do what then?
Forget about
yours and assimilate. And what happens when you assimilate into another culture? You take on all of that and you lose yours. Mm-hmm. That's why they push for this so much. That's why they push for inclusion and all of this madness. As soon as you're talking about pulling out or having something of your own, being amongst your own, they want to look at you as being what? A cult or something like that. Mm-hmm. And that's what has happened to the nation of Yisrael. We have assimilated into the culture of the people that oppressed us and now rule over us to, we've lost our identity. Yeah. But thank the Most High for He promised what? That He would never leave what? Or utterly destroy the nation of Yisrael. He always leaves a remnant. Mm-hmm. And that remnant does what? It restores and start what? Renew the minds of the people. Begin to put the message out there.
What was that one where he said, I think it's 7,000 people hadn't bowed the knee to Baal?
Yeah, it's a Romans. Yeah, that's a Romans. We have, is Romans the 11th chapter. Yeah, I mean, this is just 11, Romans 11 chapter. You just, you know, you can read 3 to the 4. I mean, just talking about election, you know. But what said the answer of Elohim to him? I have reserved myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Even so, at this present time, also there is a remnant according to the election of. You have the word grace there. Mm-hmm. Okay, let me read on.
Verse 6. You pay very close attention to verse 6.
Verse 6. But you shall be named the priest or the Kohen, okay, of Yahuwah.
You, Yahshua, that peculiar people, a kingdom of what?
Priest.
A kingdom of priests. Read that again, Maury.
But you shall be named the priest of Yahuwah, shall call you the ministers of your Elohim. You shall eat the riches of the nations of the Gentiles, and in their esteem shall you boast yourselves.
What is that? And what?
And
men,
in,
men shall call you the ministers of our Elohim, and you shall eat what?
The riches of the Gentiles.
And in their esteem, ye shall what?
Boast yourselves.
But is this not what happened to us? He just said, no longer shall you what? Grow vineyards and what? And not eat the grapes thereof? No longer shall you build these mansions and all and not live in them? Because what was happening when we went under the curses? When them curses were really hidden? Weren't we doing all the growing? And did we eat of all the
No.
But Master did. Who y'all thought built those Victorian style houses and stuff?
Right.
Oh, the plantation houses and all.
Oh yeah.
It was us.
It was us. But did we live in them?
Not we did.
So you see what's happening here? Did Maury say that that yet remains a what? A rest for Israel? And that yet remains some servitude for these nations. That's why I love this book. It keeps everything in perspective. People can say what they want to say. It just lines it right back up. And just pulls everybody right back into the right mindset. People don't understand. The nation of Yisrael have been treated so bad. And one thing I would say, the Most High promised the nation of Yisrael captivity for their disobedience.
That's right.
But they didn't consider the latter. The nation didn't consider. He was never going to leave Israel in captivity. He knew that was a day of redemption to come. But what did the nation do? They went far beyond what he wanted them to do. That's why when you read all the other captivities, this last captivity that the nation of Yisrael have been in, they called it peculiar and unusual. It was just that bad. And this is why the Most High will make the nation pay. Because, see, the story don't get told. Let me tell you, I want y'all to hear me real good. I want Comcast, YouTube, Facebook, everybody to hear me real good. When it came down to the transatlantic slave trade, they're not telling you all the hands that was involved with it.
That's right.
That's it, yeah.
I'm talking about even all the way back over to the Eastern Hemisphere. A lot of people's hand was involved with that. And this is why the Most High, he ain't just going to beat one nation. He's going to beat them all. Didn't he not say, he said, I'm going to call the, every nation down into what? The Valley of Jehoshaphat?
Yeah.
What was he calling every nation?
Because every nation had a hand.
Every nation has to be judged. And he told you why he was doing it. Why did he say he's bringing all these nations down into the Valley of Jehoshaphat?
To be judged.
And why is he judging them? Did he not say for part of the land and for what they have done to his people?
That's right. Psalms 83.
He's not playing. Let's go ahead and finish this up, Maury. We ain't got but a few verses here.
Okay, all right. And what you brought out in verse 6 is very important too, where it says, but you should be named the priest of Yahuwah. And then we have the word men should be called the ministers of Yahuwah Elohim. This verse is taken out of context so much. The way that the temple was set up, women did not do temple ministering services.
Could not.
That's a no-no. Mm-hmm. All right? Those positions were done by the Levites, the men. You even have a court of the women. Okay, the way that the temple was, the way that it was set up, everybody had their rightful place in what they did as far as service was concerned regarding ministering the word. But this society now has taught, again, this whole independent thing, that she can function without the Ish, and they have also taught that you can actually function, because there's a lot of Israelite churches now, or congregations, are teaching now is that you don't even need the Mashiach. So you see what's going on here now is that they're taking out the mediators now in both situations. You have the Father, you have the Mashiach, you have the man, and you have the woman. Some congregations now are non-messianic, where they're teaching now the Father, the man, and the woman. There's always a mediator. Always. You can't do whatever it is that you want to do. The Mashiach, being the Son, he always said, I come to do my Father's will. Mm-hmm. You have to operate under somebody's authority. And if you're not operating not under the Torah's authority, you bow the knee to Baal, is what you did. Mm-hmm. Listen to me again. Without a covering, whether the person says it or not, you have bowed the knee to Baal. It's what you have done. To show how this is so interesting is that now when you look at the book of Isaiah, the 6th chapter, verse 7, we're going to read this now in the Greek Septuagint, not in the King James Version, not in the Masoretic text. It says, thus shall they inherit the land a second time. This is in Isaiah, this is the book of Isaiah, the 61st chapter, verse 7. But in the King James Version, the Masoretic text, it reads, for your shame, it has in parentheses or in brackets, you shall have double.
Double.
And for your confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess the double. No problem. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. Because there are scriptures to back it up. But what we're trying to share here now is that there remaineth a rest for Israel. This is not our homeland. In the Greek Septuagint, which now was before the Masoretic text, the way that is written is this way. Thus shall they inherit the land a second time. Morey has been talking about a redeemer. Deuteronomy 28:68 says that, you know what? And no man shall buy them. The only way that Israel is going to be redeemed out of this captivity, the one that put them into captivity and that died for them, they've been redeemed by the blood of Yahusha HaMashiach, that's your Redeemer. It's all here. But whether or not you and I are going to accept all of Torah is up to you.
Yep.
A second time. We're talking about the second coming of Yahusha HaMashiach. And again, this month of Elul is very, very important. Okay, because the way that our calculations have it running is that on the 18th, I believe it's Wednesday sundown, until Thursday sundown, we're going to be in the seventh month. Okay, Yom Teruah, the blowing of the shofar. A lot of people have already done it. No problem. We're not getting into any arguments with that. But everybody understands that the seventh month is very, very important. The blowing of that shofar. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, Amore?
Oh, no, I'm good, Amore.
Okay.
We're going to finish the last four verses, 8 through 11.
Okay, these last four verses, all right. For I, Yahuwah, love judgment. I hate robbery for burnt offerings. And I will direct their work in truth. And I will make an everlasting covenant with them.
Who's the them?
Yahshua. Now, verse 9. And their seed shall be known among the Gentiles of the nations, and their offsprings among the people. All that see them shall acknowledge them. Not as Negroes, niggas, and spicks. None of that. And all that see them shall acknowledge them as priests, as it tells us in verse 6. And all that see them shall acknowledge them that they are the seed which Yahuwah hath blessed.
And when you said they shall what? Acknowledge them that they are the seed.
Yep.
We're talking about a seed line, a bloodline.
That's right.
This has nothing to do with the other nations. But you notice he said it's going to be where? The seed shall be what? Amongst the nation or amongst the Gentiles?
Mm-hmm.
He wants to rub it in their face. I mean, it's not like they're going to be where. They're going to have to see this. He said, I'm going to esteem you before the eyes of the Gentile. There ain't nothing going to be in secret or behind the curtain but this.
That's right.
You know how people like to, you know, y'all said they like to rub it in with us.
Mm-hmm. Everywhere you look.
How they rub it up in? When you look at television, who do you see represented?
Them.
You see them. I don't care.
Over us. Dominating us.
That's been right.
And even when you see every commercial, just about who do you have on it?
Yeah.
You'll find it strange. You never see a commercial where most time, if it's an affluent couple, it's never a black man and a black woman. Mm-hmm. Most time, you see, it's a white man with a black woman.
Mm-hmm.
All this stuff is purposely done.
Mm-hmm.
All of it. They love to rub it in your face.
Oh boy, it's arrogant, man.
Yeah.
And this is what the Most High gonna do. He's gonna rub it in their face. Remember last week when we talked about, he said, when no man sought to go through you, he's going to make it where they have to go through you.
Mm-hmm.
We had to go through them. What did those curses do? He said, this captivity, these curses, you're going to be in need of all things.
Mm-hmm.
On one of all things, guess what? You're going to have to go through them to get it. Mm. You can't even have clean water unless you what? Go through them.
That's right.
You can't even light up this house unless you go through them.
Mm-hmm.
Don't monthly you send in that money to who?
Them.
And we look at one another as enemies. We look at one another as enemies, but we're going to serve our enemies in the hunger and want of all things. But I'm your enemy.
You know, some of these households, you go in, you can't even get your Isha to do just simple things. You ask it, always some pushback and resilience. Now, I don't have that problem. I ain't gonna be lying. My wife's very good to me. But what I'm saying is, you get all this resilience, all this pushback, and you are supposed to be over your Isha, as the Most High have ordered. But you'll find when they go on the job, boss man ain't getting all this pushback. He ain't getting no pushback. And you'll go out of your way to do what? Please, boss. But something is wrong with that. And this is what I'm trying to show our people. Your mindset has to be right. Your thinking has to be in order. It has to line up with what is written. I know it seems real hard. There's a reason why the Most High set it up that way. He's trying to keep a lot of people from getting their head knotted up. Because let me tell y'all something. I keep saying it over and over and over again. No matter how bad, no matter how much we look at each other and we view the other as bad or whatever, what we think is bad, let me tell you something. When boo-boo hits the fan, that's going to be the most beautiful person you ever seen.
That's right.
And I don't know why Israel can't see that. You're in the midst of something. And it's going, because of what you're in, it causes you to be at odds. It causes you, a lot of times, you don't see everything eye to eye, or you don't agree all the time, because of the outside interference. But if both of us line up with what is written, we're going to see eye to eye. If we don't see eye to eye, that means we're not walking in a car.
That's right.
We're not in agreement. All because you're in the midst of what's been set up. And let me tell you, and I want all of our, and this, let me tell y'all something. I know I don't just pick out and pick on people.
No.
When the Ruach is dealing with me, I don't mind saying, I'll say what he say. And I'm telling you, I want every Israelite woman, by way of Facebook, by way of YouTube, Comcast Cable, Channel 25, I need you all to hear me. You are going to need your man. Your Ish, or your husband, you are going to need him. Because let me tell y'all something. Israel is going to have to take the blinders off and stop pretending like you don't know where this world is headed. You've read too many scriptures to know where this world is headed.
Yes.
Let me tell you something. When the system, the government fails, when it falls, and it's every man for himself, there's no police department, there's no sheriff department, there's no military anymore to protect you. Guess what? It's going to be every man on and on. It's going to be survival of the fittest.
All right.
And you are not going to want to be alone in a situation like that. Because guess what now? I don't care how large the feminist movement is. When that happens, they're going to be looking for a man.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? And this is the thing we're letting society cloud our mind. And that's why I keep telling people, and I know I don't push movies and stuff like that, but I keep telling everybody, watch The Walking Dead.
That's right.
You ever notice, what's one thing you ever notice in that movie? You notice you don't see the army coming to rescue anybody? You don't see because guess what? There's no army anymore. There's no police department anymore. There's no public safety. Guess what you have to do? You have to stick together, work together, and be protection for each other. And this is the thing. We feel like, you know, that's just Hollywood. That ain't gonna ever happen.
All right.
Y'all know how many things that we said would never be, would never happen, we would have seen it happen in this lifetime. And you think back, you be like, wow, you didn't see that coming. And the scripture is telling you how the houses are going to be raffled and the women raped.
Yeah.
And we act like this stuff just in the book, just to, I don't get it at all. I really don't. And we think that's the other nations.
Mm. It's gonna be us.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We don't understand the importance of it. And this is not, and I hope this is not going on like we're just attacking the women.
No,
and all.
Right.
I'm just trying to get my Israelite sisters to understand where we are. And let me go, I thank the Most High for Akoti Yediyahu and how, I know a lot of times we come across and we come out with these messages, but as she's, it takes a lot for her to sit here and sit in the midst, but she understands where we're coming from. So she says too in the scripture that, you know, that we're not attacking women or anything like that. Because, you know, sitting up with a group of men and stuff, you know, it takes a lot. But when your mindset is right and you're in the scripture and you align with the scriptures, it's just like you want, because you are one of us. In him there's no male, there's no female. We are one. We are all his bride. But even with that, he gave us as men a responsibility. And that responsibility is to make sure that our women are protected. And we have to constantly remind our women where they are. And not only that, our men too. You can easily forget you're in captivity and that you're in need of a savior. You're in the land of your enemies or in the hands of them that hate you. I'm not making that up. That's written in his word. You have enemies. You have a people that hate you. It doesn't get in the plane. All you got to do is cut on the television. You're like, man, they really hate us. But what I love about it is, that's what, nobody got to give you no reparation. The Most High ain't going to allow them to cheat you like that. I don't care if they did give you $14 trillion. They still ain't gave you but about 2% of what they owe you.
Right.
But when we begin to read, haven't we read today, he's going to get it for you. He's going to get it. You're going to get yours. Will we stop at all, Maureen?
Verse 10. Just like you said, Maureen, I mean, what we have to do, both men and women, we have to really be mindful of what's going on out here today, especially with this whole new thing with 5G and with this whole faster communication and what we're watching on TV. You have to be very, very careful. Both men and women. I'm going to say it again. Both men and women. All right, there's a whole lot of crap that's out there. This whole thing. But what I see a lot that's on TV is a lot of separatism where, again, this is not picking on our sisters. This is not what we're doing. But they're teaching this independent crap so hard on TV, it's ridiculous. Atlanta Housewives, New Jersey Housewives, there's a housewife in all of the states, all right? And all of them teach, all right, that you know what? I am independent and I don't need my man. That's all they teach. And they just run up and down at these TV shows, man, half naked is what they do. Mm-hmm. She's with John this week. Next week, she's with Bob. The next week, she's with Harry, Bob, all of them. But the Israelite woman was not designed, okay, to be with so many different men like that. It's just not there. Mm-hmm. But in today's society, they teach through television, television. They teach that it's okay for women to behave that way, where they can go from man to man to man to man. One too many men is too many.
Right.
I've only been with two men. That's too many. Mm-hmm. That's not the way that it was originally designed from the very beginning. Especially when you come into this walk here. Mm-hmm. It is not permissible. I don't care what... The only way that you can get away with that crap, okay, is through this Babylonian system. Mm-hmm. The only way. It is not permitted in Torah. Mm-hmm. I don't care what that woman tell you. I was watching Lifetime Movie Network. This is a woman's network. Okay, a woman's network. And they always, not sometimes, They always show a situation or situations now where the man and the woman, the white man, the so-called white man, they're together. But what happens now is that the man always gets beat up. He always gets beat up. And the rescuer now of the family is always the woman. No, anybody watch that in life? I mean, I want to know what's going on. Well, yet why is everybody so glued to this Lifetime movie network and this whole thing with HGTV? Now, again, I'm not saying don't watch these things, but when you watch these things, make sure that you use discretion when watching it. Because I begin to hear, wow, that white woman, she's really living a real nice life. She has this big, beautiful house. She has her kids and her husband. I mean, listen, that's a facade, all right? That is not real life at all. If you go behind the curtains and see what's going on, all right, there were just a couple about 2 or 3 weeks ago with this whole HGTV building houses thing. Right down here in Georgia, they're about to go to jail.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, confiscating money, the whole nine yards. Listen, these so-called elite, these Bilderbergs and these Rothschilds and all these guys here, listen, and they have their wives and all this other stuff, there's a whole lot of perverted, okay, stuff that's going on behind the closed doors, all right? You living in these big houses and things like that, listen, we ain't even gonna go there, all right? They're doing some stuff.
Yep.
Behind closed doors. You better be careful, all right, what you wish for, because it's a lie. It's one big lie that they're telling us on TV and we believe it. We believe it. I'm going to tell you this. There is nothing more stronger than that Israelite man and that Israelite woman together.
Yep.
Don't believe the hype. I don't care if they're living in a studio apartment and you have those other nations living in mansions.
Mm-hmm.
If you get a righteous Israelite woman and a righteous Israelite man living in a studio apartment, there's nothing more stronger than that. And they following Torah?
Mm-hmm.
Come on, man. You don't want to go there with me.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to go there. Mm-hmm. All right, but listen, let's finish it up.
And also, more
sure, yes.
Just to show you, you're in the land of your enemies. Y'all remember, the lady who, they gave her 5 years in prison because she enrolled her daughter in a school that was outside.
Right, right. I remember that.
And then Felicity Huffman.
Yeah.
And then with this scandal, this woman gets 14 days in prison.
In a spot. $15,000. She got $100,000.
Wow. Isn't that crazy?
That was crazy.
But this is why the Most High has to do what he's going to do. Go ahead, Bar.
Okay, verse 10. I will greatly rejoice in Yahuwah. My soul shall be joyful in my Elohim. For he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation.
Mm.
He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorn herself with her jewels. For as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and as the garden causes the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so our sovereign Yahuwah will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations.
He's going to do this what? Before all the nations.
Mm.
He's going to upgrade you
before
all the nations. And this is what I tell you.
Wow.
He's not doing anything in secret. They're going to see this. I wish I could find that scripture in the Apocrypha. But I have it. I'll get it later on.
All right.
Hallelujah. That's it for me, Maury.
Hey, that's it for me, too. Yeah. I mean, I just, again, want to put out the disclaimer. Maury and I were not beating up on sisters. What we're trying to do is put the sisters now in their rightful place as set apart daughters of Yahuwah, and don't fall for the banana in the tailpipe. Don't fall for that. I mean, really, you're set apart women. Set apart.
And we got some beautiful women too. And yes. I, you know, I often think about my wife. The Most High blessed me with a beautiful wife.
Hallelujah.
I mean, just the things that she do for me, I don't take it lightly. I really don't. I really do not. But tell you something. My wife, even when it's time to eat, you know, my wife never just go in the kitchen and fix something and say, baby, dinner ready. Not once. Not once has she ever not come to me and asked her, baby, what you want? What do you want for dinner? And once she find out what I want, you know what she would do? She would go to the market to get the salmon to grill. She'll go buy fresh vegetables. They ain't gonna do no canned vegetables and stuff like that. She does all of this stuff. And I could be a butthole and act like I don't know how, what, you know, that she's going out of her way and that she doesn't have to do that. I don't take that lightly. I always thank her for just considering me. You know, I like to eat, so I'm the type of person, you just go cook and whatever you put there, I eat it. But she never does that. She always asks me what I want every day. And she go out and get fresh stuff. I don't take that like that. I realize what a beautiful wife the Most High had favored me with. And just so many things that she just take into consideration. She's very considerate of me. Mm-hmm. And I often tell people, there's not many things that are attached to me that I'm just close to. My wife is that one thing that I don't mind going to prison for. I mean, you know, I love my wife to the point, if it come down to it, I go to jail. When it comes to her, and it's one of those things where, I don't know, I often think about, there's so many things I would just like to be able to do for her. Wow. It's just Israelite women. Our Israelite women have been through so much.
They've
been through so much. And I often pray to the Most High, I can't wait till you stand us back upright and put us in the right position. So we can parade and show off and just get, you know, just give our women whatever they want, how much of it they want. Because they, you know, quiet as a cat. I can never just overlook the fact that even me coming up, watching what my mom did by herself, it would have been easier and it was nice to have my father around, but he wasn't there. But the one thing I can say when it came to us, my mother, I remember plenty of mornings. I remember going to the bus stop, my mom walking me and my brother and sister to school or to the bus stop. And we have on these nice big puff jackets and stuff with the hoods and stuff. And that little thing my mom had walking us and she like this, my mind often goes back to that. But one thing I can say, you never saw us walking, shivering and shaking. She made sure we had on the best. She made sure her children were warm. I can remember so many times going in the kitchen and going to the refrigerator. The only thing in it is your echo from when you're talking in it. But guess what? Wow. When it was time to eat, she had something on that table for us to eat. Mm-hmm. Not one time in my life have we ever gone hungry and missed a meal. Even when I didn't, there was nothing in the cabinet, but when it was time to eat dinner, she made sure it was something there for us to eat. And I often, you know, my mom just transitioned about a month and a half ago. I think it's been that long. I'm not sure. Well, August the 9th. And I was talking to my sister, and one thing I regret, I said, there was so much I wanted to do for my mom that I didn't get a chance to do it because I've always wanted to have wealth, not so much for me. I wanted to be able to retire my mom and sit her down and not have another worry in the world.
Wow, that's
that was my, I never wanted wealth for, it has always been about what? My mama. You ever seen athletes, football players, and baseball players? What's the first thing come out of their mouth?
Mama.
Mama. Buying mama a new house. Buying mama a car. And that just show you the effect of how the Israelite woman, how Yahuwah put something in them, because he knew the men were going to be targeted. The men was always the target. It was all about destroying the man so the what? The nation would diminish. But because of these strong mamas, we were yet able to be men and grow up, and he allowed us not to be devoured. And when you, even though mama was there, she brought you up by yourself. Look at Morik and Sadabah, look at myself. Look at Zebu Yahu, Shlomo, Yaakov, Yohanan. We're yet what? Men in the truth. But we might not have made it this far if it wasn't for Yahuwah doing what? Using that woman. Using the woman. And a lot of times we don't tell it all the beauty of what the Israelite woman means. I don't even think the Israelite woman know how, I mean, her value.
Priceless.
Just priceless. I tell anybody, there's not a more beautiful thing on this earth. There's nothing beautiful, more beautiful than an Israelite woman. Nothing.
That's right.
Nothing compares to that woman.
Inside and out.
Inside and out.
There's a scripture here. It's in Ecclesiasticus. We'll let everybody go. It says, and I just opened up the book, it was right there. It says, Ecclesiasticus in the Apocrypha, chapter 25, verses, just chapter 1. In three things I was beautified and stood beautiful both before Elohim and men. The unity of brethren, the love of neighbors, and a man and a wife that agreed together. It gets no better than that. A man and a wife that agree together in Torah. Because we know now, a lot of times, just like Moray is saying, a lot of times what Moray will ask his Isha, the outside world will look at it as, you know what? Moray is being this dominating, arrogant pig of a man, a male chauvinist. This is the reason why we live set apart, and the things and the type of relationship that Moray has and we have with our Ishas is that it's set apart. It is not based upon the values of the world. There was a song out back in the day with Always Love My Mama, She's My Baby Girl, something like that. Who sang that?
OJs.
Oh, the OJs, yeah. So listen, we push and love our sisters. So that's before your time. You don't know about that. Yeah, that was before your time. But again, we love our women. We don't women bash. But everybody has to understand their respective roles here in Torah. Everybody.
That's those days.
Parky, what was that scripture?
Ecclesiasticus in the Apocrypha, chapter 25, verse 1. Any questions? All right. Okay. Everything else, Maury?
Oh, no, I'm good, Maury. It's in your hands. You can go ahead and...
Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to close the show, and we're going to have the man of the house, Zebu Yahu, to close us out. And just to double check, we have Yom Teruah.
Next week.
Next week, that's next Wednesday, right?
Yeah.
Wednesday night?
Wednesday night? It's going to be
here.
We're
doing something Wednesday and Thursday, right?
No.
Oh,
well, that's Force of Code. We have made arrangements for Force of Code.
That's all about the intruders.
No, I thought the code was the 3rd and the 10th.
Right. Right.
But 10th being a phoenix? Let me answer this, actually.
A Okay, Shabbat Shalom, Mr. Rakai out there at Facebook land.